I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, truly it is good to be in the house of the Lord. We're just in awe of who you are, God, of what you've already done in this place. How awesome it is to see salvation, to see blessing right in front of our eyes, God. Good to lift our hands, lift our hearts to you, God. Lift our voices in song and praise, God. We love you, Lord, and we're grateful we can come into your house freely, unhindered, God. No one's holding a gun to our heads telling us to renounce our faith, God. We're so privileged, so blessed in our nation to be where we're at for such a time as this, God. We don't take it lightly. And so, Lord, as we approach your word and open it up, we pray that you open it up to us. In fact, Lord, open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown and produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Truly today, God, we didn't come to hear from a man, from a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, we come to hear from you. Be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision and the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and co-workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we would ask that you bless our brothers and sisters, bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapel, for Harvest, for Oak Valley, for The Way, for Ecclesia Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist, God, for the Foursquare denominations and assemblies, for Victory, God. Lord, we just bless Crossroads, God, and our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters. Too many churches to name by name, but God, you know who they are. You know right where they're at, God. Meeting today all over the world, God, we bless them as you would bless us. And Lord, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We would ask that you protect them, that you bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, God, that you deliver them. Lord, may they endure to the end to the glory of God. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. And we say, amen. Amen. You can have a seat, get your Bibles and go with me. Once again to Hebrews, the 11th chapter, we're continuing our studies. And today we're talking about crossing the Red Sea. This is actually a part number two, crossing the sea. I like Pastor Luke's background so much, I said, I got to preach in front of that. It's just too good. And so we got this going again. I'm just playing. The Word of God has so much. It's so rich for all of us. In fact, I was watching the live stream last week. That message was so good. I was just shaking the hanky at the screen, yelling them down, and just good stuff. So glad that we have that so I can not miss out. God is so good. Crossing the Red Sea. This is part number two. Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 29. We're talking about Moses and the children of Israel. We've read about Moses' life, how he forsook Egypt, how he kept the Passover by faith, and now all of a sudden the terminology starts to change. It stops to focus just on Moses, and now it starts to go to the nation of Israel. And it says in Hebrews the 11th chapter, verse number 29, it says, by faith. Everybody say, by faith. By faith. All right, that was most of you guys, but I need some more of you guys. Maybe you missed it right there. I'd like everybody to say this because it's very important we understand what we're talking about today. Everybody say, by faith.
By faith.
By faith, they did something. See, there's no other way than you're going to please God except by faith. And that's what this whole chapter is all about. There's no other way to live your life except by faith. In other words, we'll just float through life, just bumping from side to side, pillar to post, devil's beating us up, just kind of floating down the lazy river. Whatever happens, happens, c'est la vie. See, God has not called you to that type of life. God wants you to live a life that's pleasing in his sight. And a life where you can do great and mighty things on the earth, and you can't do it unless you do it by faith. Can you say amen today? Amen. So by faith, they passed through the Red Sea. As by dry land. Very important that you take note of that. Maybe you want to underline it or circle it in your Bible. They passed through the Red Sea. How? By dry land. Okay, now we'll talk about why that's important a little bit later on in the message today. And it says, whereas the Egyptians attempting to do so were drowned. Now, while we're talking, I want you to turn with me to Exodus, the 14th chapter, because we're going to take a closer look at what took place in order for the children of Israel to pass through the Red Sea. See, the children of Israel had already been passed over in death. You remember that. We talked about the blood being applied to the doorposts of the life. They had been passed over in death, but now they were going to pass through in deliverance. See, there's more to our Christian walk than just getting saved. If all God wanted was for us to get saved, then it would have been like Star Trek, right? Here I am, I give my heart and life to the Lord, and now beam me up, Jesus, I'm ready to go, right? And there we go, we're off. And yet, have you noticed when you said, okay, I'm saved, Nothing happened. You didn't get beamed up. Maybe Scotty was at the helm doing all that he could, but you're still not going there yet. Why? Because there's still something that's supposed to happen. See, we are saved to do more than just get saved. We are saved to serve the living God as sons and daughters of the Almighty God, but we can't do that if we're still slaves to sin. And here God is, and he's leading the nation of Israel out of Egypt. They have literally plundered Egypt, but then they go up by way of the Red Sea. Now, there is a closer way to go up to Canaan, where they were headed, the promised land. But God did not take them the quick way. God led them by way of the wilderness. See, there was something that had to happen in their lives. Even though they had been brought out, they had been taken away and passed over in death, and now they came out of the bondage of Egypt, they still had a slave mentality that God had to get out of them. And that's what the wilderness experience was all about. God was taking those things out of them so that they would no longer be slaves, but now sons and daughters of the Most High God, and now they could come out as warriors. See, if they saw war right away, they would have fled. And they would have perished. So here God is speaking something to them. He's showing them something that they need to learn. And that's why he takes them up by way of the Red Sea. In fact, it's a fascinating study. If you ever want to do some study in the Word and you take a look at the places where they encamped, see, God brought them up to this place and he said, on one side is this place, on the other side is that place. They were literally between a mountainous area on one side and a swamp area on the other side. They had the Red Sea in front of them and Pharaoh's army coming up behind them. They were literally between a rock and a hard place. It was a sticky situation that they would have got themselves in if they would have gone in any direction. And maybe today you came into the house of God and you've got issues in your life. Yeah, you've gotten saved. You've been passed over in death. You've given your heart to the Lord and you know that you are alive. But the issue started to pursue you like Pharaoh and his army were pursuing the children of Israel. Things started coming up. It was difficult. You feel like you're between a rock and a hard place. If you go one way, it's cumbersome. The other way, it's sticky. And behind you, the devil is coming on strong. Your issues are starting to catch up with you. Yeah, there was a period of time where everything was, you know, clouds and rainbows and unicorns and all that kind of stuff. And it was like this little grace period. But now all of a sudden, that thing raised its head. You reached for the bottle once again. The friend who was your supplier gave you another joint. That pretty little thing that used to show her face or his face started coming around again. And you started slipping back into some old ways, and you wonder, what's going on, God? Why am I dealing with this? What's happening? See, God is going to get something out of you on your way. See, we're not saved just to be saved. God is saying, when we go to heaven, he wants us a certain way. And the trials and the temptations and the problems that we go through in this life are building the godly character in our lives so that when we sit on the throne with him and we rule and we reign for all eternity with Christ, we are built a certain way. Bible says we will judge angels. You can't do that if you still got the slave mentality. Come on, somebody, are you listening today? God's building something on the inside of us. He's taking us somewhere. He's leading us, and he's showing us what it is. See, passing through is what changes us. Like Pastor Luke said last week, the Red Sea moments are the defining moments of your life. When you pass through, you come out on the other side different. They were all baptized in the Red Sea, the Bible says. Same thing with us. When we're baptized, when we go down into the water, and next week is water baptism, some of you guys should do this, okay? It's an experience. When you go under one way, but you come out another way. It's a symbol of what's happened when you gave your heart and life to Jesus. And when they passed through, Moses passed through the Red Sea, right? See, on one end, he was a dead man to Pharaoh, but on the other side, he came out the deliverer of the children of Israel. Joshua, who we're going to read about in the next verse with the children of Israel, he was the learner on one side, but he was the leader on the other side. Rahab, eventually we're going to read about Rahab in the book of Hebrews. See, when they crossed over, when they passed through, Rahab on the one side was the fearful hoe. On the other side, she's the faithful hero. Come on, somebody, are you listening today? God will take your mess and turn it into your message. He will turn the test into your testimony. You will, instead of being overcome, you will be an overcomer. That's what God wants for your life. I'm preaching myself happy right now. Hallelujah. Exodus chapter 14, starting in verse number 10. We see this process. Verse number 10, it says, and when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So off in the distance, they saw the dust of their feet. And look at what it says happened. And it says, so they were very afraid. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Now stop right there and look up at me for a second. When I read this verse, oftentimes I kind of say, oh good, they cried out to the Lord. That's what they should be doing, right? Man, praise God, they cried out to the Lord. But how many of you know there can be different types of cries? Any parents in the house, right? Okay, I'm a parent, I've got three young ones at home. And sometimes there's the right cry, right? Daddy, I need help. Oh, let me come and help. Oh, we got a boo-boo. Let me get a Band-Aid on that thing, right? Let me kiss it. Let's pray. Okay, so there's that one cry. I'm happy to help. Okay? Or there's, Daddy! Some of you guys know that cry. What? He's got my toy. She took my book. Give it to him. Just like you weren't using it. It's not fair. It's mine, right? That's the wrong kind of cry. Let's see what kind of cry the children of Israel had. They cried out to the Lord. Verse number 11, then they said to Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? I think I know what kind of cry that was. Why have you so dealt with us to bring us up out of Egypt? They go on in verse number 12 to say, it would have been better for us to have perished as slaves in Egypt than to come out here in the wilderness and die. They would rather go back to slavery than to be in the place where they're at. Even though they saw the signs, even though they saw the wonders, even though they saw the miracles, even though they saw the deliverance, even though they were passed over in death miraculously. See, even though they had all this, they said it would have been better for us to go back to slavery. Why? Because their mindset had not changed yet. They had not yet been delivered. Even though they were passed over in death, they still needed to be delivered. Many of us in our Christian walk carry around old mindsets. We carry around these old ways and we say, God, I'm going through this pain. I'm going through this trial. The devil is pressing me. I'm between a rock and a hard place. And I see in front of me an insurmountable obstacle. There's no boat. There's no way I'm walking across. I don't see how this is going to happen. It'd be better, God, for me not to have given my heart to the Lord. Or wasn't it great in the good old days when we could just do whatever we want? We could tilt back a cold one with the buddies. We could go around and do our thing, you know. And yet God is saying, listen up. I want you to pass through those things. I want you to go right through the center of that problem. I want to take you through a process that will build in your life the character that I need in you so that you can rule and reign forever and ever. Hebrews chapter 3:19, we see why we can't stay in this sort of unbelief and doubt. Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 19, I'll put it up on the overheads for you. It says, so we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. See, if we don't cross over into faith, by faith they passed through the waters of the Red Sea, as on dry land. You're not going to cross through anything if you're still in unbelief. Well, I don't know if God can deliver me from this. This is a big one. I don't know if God can do this in my life. This is pretty strong. I don't know if God really knows about my situation. Yeah, everybody else, he may have the pastors covered because they're holy, and he might have those volunteers covered because they've been in church a long time, but does God really know about my situation? Does he know how long I've had this condition? Does God know how long I've been struggling? Does God know my finances? Does God know about my family? See, we get ourselves caught in these ways, and yet they could not enter in by unbelief, so that means we have to cross over in faith, believing God for our deliverance. See, if God can take Jesus, who offered up his life willingly, he laid his life down and he gave up the ghost there on the cross. He was a dead man. He had to have help getting down off the cross. Why? Because he's dead. And they had to lay him in a grave. And there he was in a sealed tomb for 3 days. And on the third day, by the power of the Holy Spirit, without anybody touching him, without anybody speaking to him, Jesus Christ was raised from the dead all on his own. And if God can raise Jesus from the dead, he can take care of your situation. It's not too big for God. God is not shocked by where you're at. Just read your Bible. They've all been screwed up since the beginning. You got brothers killing brothers. You got stepfather and fathers-in-law sleeping with their daughter-in-law. You got all sorts of crazy stuff going on. It's all in the Bible. So don't think that God doesn't know what you're going through. He's seen it all. He's been there. He's done that. He knows what's going on. He's not shocked and he's not on Prozac over your life. Hello. But God has the power to deliver you. We see in Ephesians chapter 14, as we continue on in these verses, the process that God takes to deliver us. God wants us to cross over into faith, and God wants to take us through this process of how to pass through by faith. See, there's an obstacle in front of each and every one of us. There's something that we will deal with in life, and if you're not dealing with any problems right now, just wait. You don't have to go looking for problems. Problems will find you. Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. See, we don't have to worry. We just have to know the process. And as we take you through these things, sometimes people get down on three easy steps, right? I've read blogs where people are saying that kind of preaching is not good. You shouldn't be doing that, giving people false hope. All of Christianity is not just three simple steps to success. Well, listen, first of all, I never said today was going to be easy. Come on. But I will make it simple for you, okay? Easy to understand. But sometimes, how many of you know the simple things are the hardest things in life for us to do? It may hurt. It may hurt like, you know what I'm talking about. It may hurt like, It's a place. Yeah. Might hurt like hell. I didn't cuss. It's a place. And it hurts. It burns. It might hurt you to go through the trial. You might have to walk through the fire. You might have to go through the flood. You might have to endure some things in life. There may be a tempest. There might be a demon or a devil coming against you. There might be some sort of oppression. People might get mad at you and spit at you and lie on you. You might have to go through some hard times. But listen, it is a simple process that God has called us to. Well, it may not be easy, but God will deliver you. And the reason why it's a process is because you have to do these things in order. Because if you try and skip one of these steps that I'm going to give to you today and you just try and jump to number three, it'll be like the Egyptians. Because while the children of Israel walked through by faith on dry land, the Egyptians started to do the same thing. When the cloud released and they were able to see the path, they ran in after the children of Israel. And what happened? God looked down on them and started confusing stuff. God started popping wheels off of chariots. All of a sudden, they started getting caught up in the mud. Now, wait a second. Children of Israel walked across on dry land, right? But here comes the army of Pharaoh, and they're getting stuck in the mud. What happened? See, they didn't have faith. And the same thing that was solid for one was sticky for the other. So today, you've got to do these things in order. Otherwise, you will operate in presumption, like we talked about last week, and you won't get the results that you need, okay? How to pass through by faith. We find it here in Exodus chapter 14. I'm going to read verse number 13 through verse number 16. Exodus chapter 14, starting verse number 13, says this, "And Moses said to the people, 'Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again, no more forever.'" Verse 14, "The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." In other words, shuttest thou uppest. That's the old King James Version, just in case you were wondering. Because our tongues can get us into some sticky situations, can't they? We see something, we start to cry out, and we have the wrong cry. So God says, stand still, see the salvation of the Lord, hold your peace. Verse 15, "And the Lord said to Moses, 'Why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward.'" Verse 16, "But lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea." And that's exactly what took place. Moses lifted up his arms. He stretched out the staff and his hand over the sea. There the wind started to part the sea before them. It stood up like walls, and they were able to walk through on dry ground. On both sides, they had walls of water that they were able to just walk right through the middle of it. But they had to walk through by faith. They had to believe that God was able to hold that water up. They had to believe that God was able to hold up their feet in the midst of this ground that had been saturated with water. How to pass through by faith. Three things that we see. First thing that we see that Moses said to the children of Israel is do not fear. Right off the bat, the very first thing he tells them is don't fear. Don't be afraid. You know, when I look at many people, they call themselves Christians. There's such a fear about issues. People don't want to talk about things any longer. People don't mention that in church. It's too risque. You know, it's kind of taboo in churches. And yet the world's out there talking about every nasty thing, aren't they? You see all sorts of, if you want to see sin, just turn on your TV and flip through the news, flip through the latest sitcoms, whatever it is. They're making jokes about stuff that's perverse and wrong, and yet we can't talk about stuff in church. Why? Because there's a fear associated with it. Sometimes it's pain that's associated with our issues. Why? Because I've let myself down too many times. I made an inner vow that, you know, I was never going to do that again, and I continued to do it. I prayed. How many of you did this like Pastor Dan did, right? You prayed. You said, God, I will never do that again. What happened very next day? Oh, man. God, okay. I will never, never do that. I know what I said yesterday, but today I will never do that again. That was yesterday. Brand new day. Mercies are new every morning. Next day. God, I'm sorry. I messed up. I will never, never ever do that again, right? And you end up disappointed. You stop praying. You're afraid to even go talk to God anymore because you keep messing up and you don't know what to do. And we allow fear to paralyze us. We allow the problem. We keep looking at the problem. It's insurmountable. It's like the Red Sea. I don't know how I'm going to get across this thing, God. I can't do it in the natural. I don't understand, God. I got a rock on one side. I got a hard place on the other side. Devil is bringing it back up behind me, and I can't get over it. And yet God says, don't be afraid. There's a Morris proverb that says that whatever you fear has power over you. Let me say that again. An old Morris proverb that says that whatever we fear, we give power over us. See, if we fear problems, if we fear issues, if we fear trials, then they will paralyze us. They have power over us. We will be enslaved again to sin, even though we are Christians, passed over in death. Yeah, you're going to be saved. Yeah, you're going to be headed for heaven, but you're going to live a life of bondage. Why? Because you fear the problem rather than looking to the promise. God is able to deliver you. And so you have to stand up and you have to say, you know what? I'm no longer afraid. You have to stare the monster down. I heard a story about two hunters that read a book that said that if you stare a lion down, if you get in close proximity, that the lion will actually back away from you. One hunter looked at the other one and said, well, you've read the book. I've read the book, but has the lion read the book? Let me tell you something today. The devil's read the book. He knows what God says about fear. In fact, I did a study. That's okay. Some of you guys are getting a hold of this. Some of you guys are getting released from fear today. See, I did a study on the word fear in the Bible, fear or be afraid, that sort of a thing. And of the hundreds of verses in the Bible, the majority of them are commandments to us saying, don't. Don't be afraid. Do not fear. Fear not. Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Turn there with me. In Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Hebrews, chapter 13. Kind of towards the end of the Bible, you're already in Hebrews, chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 5 and verse number 6. Take a look at what it says. It says, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. Now that thought launches into something in verse number 5 at the end. The second sentence says this, for he himself has said, speaking of God, notice it's a capital H. He himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You know what that means? It means God's with you. Wherever you go. In the middle of the night, when you're struggling with your issue, God is right there beside you, inside of you. When you feel like you're all alone, like you're lost, maybe you're in a crowd, you're in a sea of faces, and you feel like, oh my goodness, I just can't deal with this. You're struggling and you're battling. God is right there in the midst of the battle with you. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. God is on your side. Now look at what it says in response, verse number 6. What's that first two-letter word there at the beginning of verse 6? A couple of you guys caught that. How about the rest of you guys? You guys still with me? Okay, come on. What's that first little two-letter word at the beginning of verse 6? So. In other words, because God will never leave me nor forsake me, so we may boldly say. Not a little whisper. Not a little cry in the dark. No, we can shout this from the mountaintops. We can say it boldly, openly, frankly. We can say it with a smile on our face. We may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Never have to be afraid. Never have to be afraid. God is with you wherever you go. Dr. E. Stanley Jones says this. He writes, I am inwardly fashioned for faith, not fear. Fear is not my native land. Faith is. I am so made that worry and anxiety are sand in the machinery of life. Faith is the oil. I live better by faith and confidence than by fear, doubt, and anxiety. In anxiety and worry, my being is gasping for breath. These are not my native air. But in faith and confidence, I breathe freely. These are my native air. A John Hopkins University doctor says, we do not know why it is that worriers die sooner than non-worriers, but that is a fact. But I, who am simple of mind, think I know. We are inwardly constructed in nerve and tissue, brain cell and soul for faith and not for fear. God made us that way. To live by worry is to live against reality. Can you say amen? First thing in the process is don't fear. Don't fear. Don't allow fear to paralyze you. You stand up and you stare fear right in the face. Second thing is this. Moses tells them, do not fear. But then in verse number 13, he goes on to say, do not fear and stand still. Don't be running around like a chicken with your head cut off. Right? He says, stand still. Quit your activity. See, we could try and deliver ourselves in the natural. We could go out and do our thing. We could try and move on something. We could try and get rid of something. But listen, all that is behavior modification. If it's just behavior modification, there is no heart transformation. Eventually, you will end up back in the same pit. And if we're going to deal with our issues, he says, I want you to stop laboring in the natural. I want you to cross over into the supernatural. In other words, there's a stance. The way this word stand still could be translated, if you look in the other uses of the Bible, really is stand firm. Stand your ground. Take a stand against this thing. In other words, we're afraid to pray that prayer, God, I will never do that again. But you have to have by faith a resolve that says, God, I will never do that again. See, it's not a bad prayer to pray. Yes, there's going to be trials. Yes, there's going to be setbacks and things. You might stumble along the way. But listen, you have to have the stance of faith that says, I am not going to go down this way. This will not be how it is forever. Doesn't matter if my daddy, my granddaddy, and my great-granddaddy did this. I'm not doing it. It stops here and now. Ephesians chapter number 6, turn there with me, Ephesians chapter number 6, we're going to take a look at verse 13, but in Ephesians 6, you'll find the spiritual armor of God. God says, I want you to take up the whole armor of God. He says, I want your helmet, I want you to put on your helmet of salvation. I want you to put on that breastplate of righteousness that covers you. I want you to gird yourself, I want you to bind yourself together with truth. I want your feet fitted with the readiness, the preparation of the gospel of peace. You're ready to tell someone about Jesus anytime, any place. I want you to take up the shield of faith. I want you, your faith to be like a shield. It's able to extinguish the fiery darts of the wicked one. And finally, I want you to have the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, which you can hack and you can slash away at the enemy. And so he says, I want you to do all that. And then at the end of this, he says, in verse number 13, he says, because we're fighting a spiritual fight. Verse 13, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand. Take your stand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, I like how it says in the Message paraphrase, he says, when all is over but the shouting, you'll be able to stand your ground, firm and secure. You will be able to say, you know what? This is how it's going to be. I'm not losing ground. I'm not going back. I'm not going down. I am going onward. I am going upward. And this is my stance. There's a story of a man by the name of Alexander Kuhn that Dr. Maxie Dunham writes about. Alexander Kuhn was the leader of the Methodist Church in Estonia during the days of Stalin. Fierce persecution came out against the church. Now, we had one of our members in one of the previous services that was Romanian, and he actually was letting me know that communism was bad. Just so you all know, Stalin, yes, bad, okay? Communism, bad. We get that. And they were persecuting the church, okay? And so they came to Alexander Kuhn, who was the leader of this church, and they said, we want you to do one of two things. This is how it's going to be. You're either going to dissolve your church and stop meeting altogether, or you're going to merge with another church. Now, Alexander Kuhn stood his ground. He said, no, we're not doing that. Now, they came and they said, it would be easier to give in and merge than to be forced by the government to dissolve. Kuhn stood firm. They asked, what difference will it make whether you take the easy way without raising a lot of questions and allow the church to be merged, or we force the issue and banish the church. Now listen to Coombe's response. Coombe responded, there's all the difference in the world. If you give me a piece of rope and you tell me to hang myself and I do it, then I'm responsible. But if you take a rope and you hang me, you're responsible. Coombe would not back down. He wouldn't do it. They ended up banishing him to a Siberian prison camp with a 25-year sentence. While Coombe was away in prison, the church grew and became more powerful there in Estonia. And in 5 years, Coombe was released miraculously. See, you may go through a hard time. When you take that stance, all hell might break loose against you. The devil does not want you successful as a Christian. He already gave you up to the Lord, and now he has to release you from death. But he wants to make sure that you're ineffective and unproductive in your walk with God. So what's he going to do? He's going to bring these issues back. He's going to bring old relationships back. He's going to bring old vices back. He's going to try and come against you and shoot these fiery darts. But if you will take your stand, you will go right through the problem and the trial. Last thing in the process is this. Not only don't fear. Not only stand still or stand firm, finally is move forward. You say, well, that doesn't make any sense. I'm supposed to stand still and move forward? Yes. Here's how that works. You take that stance of faith and you move forward with that stance. In other words, I'm standing firm in my resolve that this is not going to happen anymore, and I'm going to move forward based on the word of God. Okay? One step at a time on the ground of truth. You cannot move forward in faith without a word from God. Otherwise, you're going to be operating in presumption. Remember, the Egyptians, they did not have a word from God to move forward. Yet when they tried to cross, they ended up confused, they ended up stuck in the mud, and eventually they ended up dead because the walls of the water fell down on them and drowned them all. The children of Israel looked at their bodies on the seashore. We have to not be afraid to stand up and to stare our issues in the face. Secondly, we have to stand firm with a resolve that this is not going to be how it is. But then we need to get a hold of the word of God and move forward on the solid ground of God's truth. Are you listening today? So you say, how do I do that? Here's how. You find a scripture that deals with your situation. What is it? Think about it. What am I dealing with? What am I facing? Maybe it's not a sin issue. Maybe it's a stronghold. Maybe it's something that the devil's bringing against you. Maybe it's a problem or a trial, and it seems insurmountable, and the devil is coming after you with it, hounding you with it. You don't have enough. Not going to make it. You're still sick. What's wrong with your faith? Find a scripture. Find a scripture. Maybe it is a sin. Maybe you're struggling with pornography or addiction. Maybe you're struggling with alcohol or anger or whatever it is. Find a scripture that deals with your situation, and then move forward in faith, stepping out on the word of God. See, that's how it works. Let me show this to you in the book of Romans. You're there in Ephesians. Turn back to the book of Romans now. Romans chapter 6. I would encourage you that if you're dealing with something, you're battling a sin, maybe it's a besetting sin that you've dealt with over and over and over again in your life, get a hold of Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 7, and Romans chapter 8. Now, for time's sake, I'm only going to read a couple of verses in Romans chapter 6. But during the week, I would encourage you to sit down, pray, ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you, get a pen and a paper out, and sit down with the Word of God, open up Romans chapter 6, and read straight through Romans 6, 7, and 8. And as you go through, whatever the Holy Spirit speaks to you, just start writing stuff down. And allow the Holy Spirit to minister the Word of God to your life. He is the teacher, and He will teach you. Romans chapter 6, we're going to take a look at verse number 11 through verse number 13. Okay, talking about stepping out and moving forward on the word of God. Now, Jesus died, and the Bible says in Romans chapter 6, the first part, that Jesus died, the death that he died to sin once and for all, and the life that he lives, he now lives unto God. Now, in verse number 11, it says, likewise, or in the same way that Jesus died to sin and was resurrected and raised to life again to God, it says, likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, we don't use that word reckon unless we're from the South, right? I reckon. But really, the meaning still stays the same. It means that you have added up the facts, that you've calculated it out, and you have come to a conclusion about something. That's what it means to reckon. Really, it's an accounting term. You've added up what the different things are, and now you've come to this conclusion. So he says, reckon yourselves, or add up the facts about your life, to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God. What does that look like? Now, if I took a gun and I went down to the funeral home right up the street here, and I went inside of the funeral home and I held that gun out and I pointed it at the person in the casket and I said, "Stick him up." Nothing's going to happen, right? Hopefully nothing happens. I said, "Give me all your money. I'm going to blow you away." Nothing, right? Why? They're dead, right? But if I took that same gun and I turned around on the crowd, all of a sudden we've got pandemonium in the place. Why? Because, hey, they're still alive. They're still going to respond. So in other words, when sin comes and says, "Stick them up," I'm dead to sin. I don't respond to sin. But we're alive to God in Christ Jesus. So when we hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, "Yes, Lord, I'm ready. God, here I am. What do you want me to do, God? Oh, you know a way through this? All right, God, I will step out on your word." See, we are dead to sin, but we are alive to God. Look at verse number 12. Therefore do not let. In other words, it's your choice. You can either let it happen or you cannot let it happen. You can either be afraid of it and cower in fear and submit to it, or you can say no. And you can stare that monster down and take a stand in faith and not let that happen anymore. You can delete the number of that person from your phone that keeps dragging you down. You can get rid of the internet sites or the passwords that are getting you in trouble late at night. You can get rid of those things that are dragging you down that you hid in the garage. Whatever it is, you can get rid of. You cannot let. Do not let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in its lust. Listen, you were delivered from that bondage. You no longer have to serve as slaves of sin. Now you are sons and daughters of the Most High God. Verse 13, and do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. You don't have to be a tool in the hands of the devil for evil any longer. You don't have to say, "I guess this is how I was born. I guess this is how I was made. Everybody else in my family had this, and now I have it too." No! You've got a brand new life in Christ. You've got a new DNA. You've got a new family. You've got a new dad. You've got a new brother. You've got a new sister. And you can be like big brother Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit. But look at what it says. Do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. God wants to use you. You are a tool in the hands of Almighty God of righteousness. God wants to use you to reach a lost and dying world. You can go out and you can tell someone about Jesus. You can go out and you can distribute his goodness here on the planet. You can pray in the will of God on the earth. You are a weapon in the hands of the ultimate warrior. His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. But it all comes down to our choice. When we step out on the word of God, what is the process of deliverance? How are we going to pass through by faith? Number one, don't be afraid. Don't fear. Fear is the opposite of faith. Fear will take you out of faith. Secondly, stand still, stand firm. And then thirdly, move forward based on the word of God. See, as they passed through, they went from being oppressed to being overcomers. And it's no different for each and every one of us today. Today I want to pray for people. I'm going to give another altar call in a minute. Okay, so I want to prepare you for that. I don't know if anybody will respond. Last service we had more people respond at the second altar call. And I'm going to do that in a moment. But I want to make sure before you leave this place that if you're dealing with a situation, if there's an insurmountable obstacle in front of you. Maybe there's been a sin that you've been dealing with, an issue that keeps coming up in your life, and today you've got faith, and you're saying, "You know what, I'm not afraid anymore. I want to take a stand." Maybe you're not afraid, but you just haven't done anything. You haven't had that stance that, "You know what, I'm not going to let this go on any longer." Maybe it's not a sin. Maybe you're looking at a financial burden. Maybe you're looking at a pressure or a weight in a relationship, something that you just have no control over. And it looks like the Red Sea in front of you. You're between a rock and a hard place, and the devil's trying to beat you up from behind. Today, you can take a stand in faith. And I want to pray for people today to have a word from God dropped into their spirit. Maybe it's a scripture, maybe it's an instruction, maybe it's an appointment or something like that, that God wants to speak to your heart today and give you the word of the Lord, and that you can step out in faith as on dry ground, the solid ground of God's truth. If that's you in this place, you're dealing with something, you're facing a situation, facing an obstacle, maybe you want to deal with an issue, deal with your sin, I want you to stand to your feet right now, right where you're at, if you want to be included in this prayer. There's no shame today. We're not calling out sins or anything like that. You can stand. And before God, God knows. If you need to stand, go ahead and stand up. Facing something, you're saying, I don't know how I'm going to make it through. God knows how. Go ahead and stand to your feet right now. God will give you the word. God will give you the word. Anybody else in this place? I'm gonna just take one more minute. If you need to stand, maybe you're struggling, you're battling. Listen, don't let fear paralyze you. You want to hear the word of the Lord on how to move forward. Take a stand today. Don't be afraid. Anybody else real quick? And then we're going to pray. Anybody else? Okay, I'm going to pray a simple prayer. It's a prayer of faith, believing God. I'm going to ask God to drop his word. Maybe it's a scripture. Maybe it's an instruction into your heart. And I want you to just hold on to that word today. Lift your hands to the Lord. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you are Almighty God. There's nothing too great for you. God, you know every person in this place and these that are standing before you with their hands raised to you, God. You know their situation. You know their difficulty. You know their life. You know the Red Sea that they're standing in front of, looking across, desiring to be on the other side. And God, you also know the pathway through. And God, we declare that we are not afraid. Not afraid of the devil, not afraid of the problem, not afraid of the trial, God, not afraid of what's coming. God, but we're in faith, believing you. Today, we take a stand, God. We say this is not how it's going to be. We believe, God, that we're going to cross over and pass through to the other side. So, Lord, we would ask that you give us the word of the Lord on what to move forward on in our lives. God, I pray and I ask that you would drop that word into our hearts right now in Jesus' name. Now, I'm just going to be quiet. Just listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you that you've spoken your word to us today. God, thank you for the scriptures and for the instructions and for the assignments that were dropped into our hearts. God, we will be faithful. God, we will move forward. God, we commit to remember and to do what it is you've called us to do. In Jesus' mighty name, God, we thank you that you're with us all the way through to the other side. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hallelujah. God is good. You can have a seat. Now listen, if God spoke a scripture to you, if God spoke and instructed you, write it down, okay? Because you're going to forget it. I know because I forget stuff when I don't write it down, all right? We're all in the same boat. So just write it down real quick. Tell your spouse if you're married or your friend if you're sitting there together. Just tell them, hey, God spoke this scripture to me or God spoke this to me, okay? Commit it to memory and make sure to be diligent. Don't wait. If God told you to get rid of something today, get rid of it, okay? If God told you to cut off a relationship, delete that number out of your phone, do it. Now, it's okay. You can delete numbers in church. It's all right, okay? Now, like I said, I'm going to give another altar call right now. So I'm going to ask everybody, please remain seated. Nobody get up. No one walk around. Very important because I want to make sure before we leave this place. There may have been some of you that came in after the praise and worship, and you came in partway through the message, and God dealt with your life, and you said, man, that was great, and I really do feel like God spoke to me today. But here's the problem is that your heart's not right with God, and if you died, you'd end up in hell, and you wouldn't go to heaven. You say, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. Well, listen, hell's a very real place. Jesus talked about it, talked about it in the Old and New Testament, and just by denying its existence doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. And not all roads lead to heaven. Can't do whatever you want to do and expect to make it there. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me, and it means it's God's heaven. You're going to have to get there God's way. And so today I want to show you that way in the Bible. Sometimes people think if I can just be good enough or I can just attend enough church, maybe if I can do enough good stuff in church, volunteer and help out, maybe if I know enough scriptures or I wear a cross or St. Christopher around my neck, or maybe if I know who God is and celebrate Christmas and Easter, can memorize some scriptures and quote them, maybe that gets me right with God and headed for heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that our good works will get us into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say just sit in church service, sit in a seat in a sanctuary, warm up a spot, and that gets you right with God, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. But Jesus said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, it's not based on your works, it's not based on your church attendance, it's not based on your volunteerism, and it's not based on your knowledge of God. But rather, this is based on something that takes place spiritually. Jesus said, you must be born again. Now, I know that sounds weird. I know that Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet have made it out to be a mockery. And yet, let's not let society defined for us what being born again is. Because unless you're born again, you're not going to make it. So listen up, those of you in this place. You know you're not right with God. You know that you need to get right with God. And you know you've been doing it in your own works, and today all of that wind just got knocked out of your sails, and you're saying, well, then what do I do? Jesus said you must be born again. What does that mean from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible? It's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Here's what he's saying, in or out. Either you are or you aren't. If you're playing games, then you're not going to make it. Jesus said, I'd rather you say I'm not a Christian and go do your own thing than to say that you're a Christian and be half-hearted. Half-hearted will only get you halfway, not the whole way. You're not going to make it with God. So today I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Today, your call, your choice. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear that sound, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. But think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. And yet you probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better. It's better. Today, who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day, make sure. Who should raise your hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart. Get ready to get right with God. Get ready to get your hand up. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands if that's you. One, two, thank you. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. There's three up top there. Thank you. Who else today? Four right there. Got you right there. Thank you. Four. Wise people. Five, six over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? Who else? Back in that family room, is there anybody? No? Okay, thanks, Tom. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Real quick. Is that a hand right there? Wave it at me if it is. Okay. All right. Praise God. Anybody else real quick? Just want to make sure that we don't miss out on you. If that's you, thank you. Oh, I got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. Got you guys right there. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? All right. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Wow. So cool. Right, if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, get ready to get a hold of your cold purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in there, I'll meet me up front. We're going to change destinies today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand, and let's welcome them. Come on, you come right now. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand. You come. Come to the front right now. Come on down. They're coming. They're coming. Come on right now. You can come too. Come on, they're still coming. You can come too. Even if you didn't raise your hand, you can come to the front right now. If your children raise their hand, they can come too. This is their time too. Come on, they'll remember this. All the way in the back, you raise your hand. Come on, wherever you're at. Be bold. Take a stand today. They're coming. They're coming. Come on, this is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Anybody else, if you need to come, just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. All right, hey, you guys. Congratulations. Best decision of your life right here. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel. Good guy, nothing weird goes on. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart, going to be born again, give you some free information, talk to you about a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. It's easy, it's free, okay? And he'll talk to you about how that works, and then he'll let you come right back out in the church service. Your friends and family will wait for you, okay? Welcome to the family of God. Turn to your left, follow Pastor Joel. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.